Thank you, Jim.
Thanks,
thank
Jim.
You, everyone. Jimmy, thank you so much for coming
cool.
and talking with us today.
That's me. I thought I'd just shut it off.
It is a conference about
technology.
Well,
there goes innovation.
Right. So you've had a really remarkable career in an industry that has been pretty much under attack from one form or another of digital technology for nearly 20 years. When we go back to 1999, which was kind of the heyday of the music industry posted $38 billion in global sales that year. And starting in 1999, we had Napster, MP3, Rhapsody, iTunes, Spotify, Pandora, YouTube. The list goes on and on. The industry response to these potential disruptions was to fight like hell. Try to shut down the technologies and keep from happening what was looking like it was going to be free access to digital content. Last year, the industry posted $16.5 billion in earnings, so clearly that it hasn't worked. Most actually now believe that if the industry is going to recover, it will likely be due to the very disruption that it's been watching due to digital, as more and more businesses look toward the benefits of digital business models. In fact, Edgar Berger, chief executive of Sony Music Entertainment internationally in 2013, said that digital is saving music. So then there's you. In 2004, you were talking to the enemy, you were talking to Apple about subscriptions. You followed that up with several deals with iTunes. In 2013, you launched your own disruption, Beats Music, which is the very first subscription service to offer true personalization by, restoring the human interface into subscription curation. So while virtually everybody in the music industry is panicking, you embraced the change and you innovated again. What did you see that nobody else saw?
Well, you know, it all goes back to one thing. You know, there's a quick story that in around 2000, I saw that there was an issue. You know, that I just smelled trouble, right? Or maybe I'm good at smell. Maybe I'm insecure, paranoid, but I just smelled it. You know, so I said, this is much bigger than anyone thinks. The problem is much bigger than anyone thinks because I spent my life trying to know what young people do and how they react to things. I said, they're going to like this. You know, free music, right? It sounds really good. So, you know, you don't have to leave your home. You don't have to ask your mother to drive you to the record store. You get to just sit there on your computer and it comes to you free. That can't miss, right? So I went down. I wanted to meet someone in the tech world because I didn't know anyone in that business. So someone got me a meeting with Les Valdez, a guy who was running Intel at the time, and I went down there and I pleaded my case. I said, look, you know, this is not going to hurt. I just saw one thing. I said, this is not going to hurt me or the senior people at record companies. It's going to hurt the young people that want to get into music and musicians. It's going to devastate. And I told him this for 20 minutes, and then he finally spoke, and he said, you know, what an incredible story. He says, but Jimmy, not every industry was built to last forever. And I was terrified. I said, is that possible? I said, this guy scares me to death. And by coincidence, Doug Morris is here, who's the CEO of Sony Music, and it was the CEO of Universal at the time. I called him up. I said, we are screwed. And you know, from that day on, I, along with Doug, have been trying to figure out, okay, what do we do in this thing? So the reaction that the industry had was to sue. There was a couple of people running the label, working at the labels that were lawyers, and they just said, okay, the only thing we can do here is take a very aggressive position and treat it as a copyright issue. This all leads to the school and when I met Erica and Max, because what happened? The record industry had zero feel for technology and the internet. So we didn't understand anything about it. And what you see today, 15 years later, with Steve Jobs out of the picture, there was a tech business that has zero feel for popular culture. And those things have to come together for there to really be great products and great interaction. So, but anyway, not jump ahead. Then I met Steve in 2003, And he showed us iTunes. Doug sent me as an emissary for Universal to go up there and see it. And I was floored at what he was doing and the simplicity of it, because I figured, okay, this is not perfect. We're going to be selling singles again, and this is not perfect. I said, but we're never going to get music on. I called Doug, who was my boss, and I said, we are never going to get music on online legally, because all these lawyers are just looking for some kind of bulletproof way to license our music. I said, this guy, it's simple, and here's the competition. He's going to be selling music, and right now, if a kid wants to get music, he either stops doing his homework, asks his mother, take me to the store, park the car, buy a record, come back, start my homework again, right? Or go on Kazaa, and it's 30 seconds, and he has it, it's free, his mom doesn't know anything. That wins, right? So I said, at least this is a shot at getting music online, and we can push from there and achieve something. So that's kind of what the beginnings of the entire movement was
It seems like you felt really comfortable moving away from what the industry was trying to do to shut this down, because I think you felt that culture was the key.
Well, you see, I follow cool. I never thought for a minute that I was cool, but I knew that if I got into music, I could be cool by association. So I got into music, and what happened was the first thing I realized wasn't that I was going to lose money, is that I wasn't in what was cool and new and exciting. That's what first got my attention, and that's no yeast, right, as Doug would say. That's just the truth. I said, and then when I went up to see Steve Jobs, I said, oh, the party's at this guy's house, you know? And I said, this is a horse of a different color. This is brand new. This is John, Paul, George, and Ringo, Mick, and Keith, and one guy. I said, okay, we got a problem. So I went back, and I said, okay. And then I learned, and I realized, okay, this is where we need to be headed. So I watched him beheaded. I watched him, and I said, okay, he's making hardware and marketing it through software. He's the only guy making software and hardware, but yet he's marketing it through popular culture with iTunes. I said, this is a great idea. I said, maybe I can't, I'm not gonna do it better than him, but I can most certainly copy it. I said, because what I have is I have the most powerful popular culture in the world at our record company. If I can harness that and make a piece of hardware that's really good and looks great, I know I can sell these things. And that's kind of how we ended up in the headphone business.
That's actually my next question. The transition from content or software to hardware, almost nobody has been able to do that in the tech industry, and you have. So talk a little bit more, if you can, about the transition from founder and chairman of Interscope Geffen A&M to co-founder and CEO of Beats.
Well, you know, I keep mentioning his name because he's been such a great, great person in my life, which is Doug Morris. He was my boss. And in 2004, my contract was up. And I went to him and I said, Doug, I can't sell CDs anymore. I'm not going to sell be the guy who sold the last CD. I'm just not that guy. He said, yeah, but you have to stay here. You could do more for the industry inside. It'd be great for you. And so we went and asked the French. And we worked for Vivendi. And they said no. And Doug got them to give me my new contract where I could actually innovate and start a business within the company. And it was an incredible thing. It was a very bold thing. And then I went on a mission. And, that thing that Steve Jobs was doing with these shiny white objects was always in my mind, and how he was using our stuff to push it out. And everyone's saying, wow, this is the coolest thing in the world. I said, yeah, but part of what's making it cool is what we're doing for him at Apple and iTunes. So I said, okay. And I was walking down the beach one day, and I ran into Andre Young, Dr. Dre, and he was on the beach, and I was exercising. And I said, how are you doing? He goes, Dre is very soft-spoken, doesn't talk much. He just said to me, yo, my lawyer, he wants me to sell sneakers, man. What do you think? I said, Dre, nobody in the world cares how you dress or will care about your sneakers. What you should sell is speakers. And at that moment, and he said to me, we could do that? And I said, blank, yeah. and it all hit me at once. Steve Jobs, the record business, the iPod, Dre, cool. And it all hit me at once. I said, let's do this. And he said, well, you know, I use this word beats. You know, I make beats, right? So it's like Beats by Dr. Dre. I said, okay. Beats by Dr. Dre, headphones and speakers. He says, I'm in. And that was the beginning of the company. But that's exactly how it happened.
Yes. So get to a beach quickly. And
by the way, we were both recording engineers in a former life. See, we were, you know, he started as a recording engineer and so did I. And we always bonded on sound. And we also felt something that's very important is that I started to realize that everybody outside of Apple was culturally inept in tech. So I started to say, okay, you know, like in those movies where it's the hero's job to find the weakness in the aliens that land and they have a certain amount of time to do it. I said, well, this is where these guys are weak. They have no clue about popular culture. And I said, especially in the headphone business, they all look like medical equipment. I said, and I don't like the way they sound. I said, if we've changed the sound and changed the design, we're gonna kill them. You know, and today we have 55% of the worldwide headphone market.
Yeah, which is
about
it's an extraordinary number, just extraordinary.
Well, of course, there was that weakness.
I was actually going to go a different place, but I have to talk about this culture thing that you keep bringing up. Just today, an article in Bloomberg talking about, and in fact, the headline is amazing. The headline is NFL Bose deal provides Jordan boost to competitor Beats. And you and I were just talking a little bit ago about the fact that if somebody in that organization had understood popular culture, they would have understood that outlawing Beats in the NFL would have precisely backfired in the way that it did. And so this is an interesting phenomenon. It really comes down to understanding how people are going to respond. Even when you lose, you win.
Well, Dre and I and the people at Beats, to us, the biggest sin you can commit in business or in art or any kind of profession is to breathe your own exhaust, is to have some success and then go, okay, we must know what we're talking about, you know? So we never do that. We always approach it like the first day from the very first record we made. Every day you say, okay, what can we do better? And what happened was, I believe, one of our competitors just says, well, this is how we're gonna do it. We're gonna bully our way into this. We're loved by athletes because we make headphones that sound very emotional with the bottom end and the effect of them and the top end, the power of them. So they exercise to them, you know? So we went there on music and sports because we knew that there was a big hole in that market. And we also know how athletes work out and how they feel about music. These are all young guys or young girls around the world, whether it's soccer, whether it's, you know, tennis, they all work out to music. And I believe that our headphones give them that little extra push that they need. So our competitors don't know that or don't care, or maybe they just have no way of finding out. So what happened there is you have a tech company that's culturally inept. There's no one at the company that said, if you ban these guys, you're going to look bad to the young people, and they're going to look like superheroes, even though they just are pure they are not pure capitalists, but they are real capitalists, and just sold their company to Apple, but you're going to make them look like the underdog. We didn't do anything. And you know, now the players are going out putting black tape on our logo, which is, it's like, I can't believe I'm this lucky. You know, it's like, I'd be like sending them the tape. But it's a very typical thing of I believe, Dre and I and our team believes that every company, if it's a tech company, it needs someone senior in there that has something to say, that has a feel for popular culture. And if it's a media company, someone in there should have a feel for the internet and a feel for tech that has something to say, that's a senior person, not someone 20 levels down that happens to have a computer, so he's the head of digital. You know, it's absurd. And that's what our school is about.
Right, it is, absolutely. So the estimates today are that Beats garnered about $2.4 million in free advertising.
Well, that number is crazy as well, because you can't buy what we got.
Right.
Technically, if you put our headphones on TV that many times on ESPN or CBS, it would be worth $2.4 million. But how valuable is it for the entire country to go, wow, these guys are cool, and these guys look pretty lame.
Right.
You know, that's worth more than $2.4 million, you know? So yeah. It was an, by the way, this is really a crazy thing. In London, we got banned in London for the Olympics. Okay, what happened? The next day, we had a little pop-up store in the village for athletes. The next day, 2,000 athletes showed up outside of our little tent because we were giving out headphones. The day after they banned us, we go to the World Cup. They banned us from the World Cup. Same thing. Why? Because athletes love us, and Sony Electronics bought the rights to put their posters up there. You know. So they ban us from, you know, it's crazy. What do the athletes go? They go, wait a second, you don't own us. We're not doing this. We, you know, we're not getting paid for this. So they wore the headphones. It's a piece of equipment. It's like their shoes. It's no different than their running shoes. So, I mean, again, these are companies. It's not about Beats. It's about the school. And this school, if you're really favor technology, you should have a feel for popular culture. And if you are really strong in media and the arts, you should have a feel for tech. That's all we're saying. Dre and I didn't go to college. We're not some geniuses by any stretch. It's just, we were trying to hire people. You get one or the other. And, you know, 1 + 1 doesn't equal 2 in this particular case. You want one person that has a feel. You want everyone in your company to possibly have a feel, or at least know the language of the other. And Steve Jobs, yes, he was this fascinating, unique individual, but he created something much more than the Mac. He created a blending of tech and liberal arts that's going to be around forever. And these companies are going to have to catch up. And what we're hoping to do is build students that'll take that baton and really crush it.
So one of the really nicest things that I've heard you say about the Academy, you had a really circuitous route in your career. You talked about starting as an engineer, which is the creative side of music. You moved into the business of music, and now you are in the technology of music. And one of the things that you said to me was, I don't want these kids to have to take that long path that I took to be able to understand the natural connections between these areas and to be able to innovate by being able to understand, you know, where they connect and how they connect. The Academy has just opened its doors this fall. You finally saw the garage the other day. You've met our students a couple of times. I was really pleased to actually, you know, to see the visible joy on your face when you came out from seeing the way the kids intersect with the garage and what a different learning experience that is for them. It's not a program that's going to be easily duplicated. And I know for a fact that there are a number of peer institutions trying to get something similar off the ground. We've been able to move on this and set the bar for everybody, obviously, because of the generosity of you and Dre and the ability to establish this quickly. The two of you, self-made men, investing in higher education. What led you to do that?
You know, everything Dre and I does completely on feel. We don't prepare for anything. I didn't prepare for this. You know, the only thing I did was I took a walk with Liberty down in the park. I didn't think about this for a minute before I walked in the room. We don't do any. We only work on instinct, really, to be honest with you. And higher education, we just said, there's a hole here. We look for holes. We look for stuff that doesn't exist and things that are just being done wrong that we can do better. And we're trying to hire all these kids to come up and work at Beats, and we're saying, well, this doesn't work, you know, because the kids that are really tech savvy don't understand how popular culture works, and the people that are really have feel don't have a clue about tech. But yet every kid today, in order to communicate at 4 years old, has to have a computer, has to understand a cell phone, and the better they understand the internet, the more entertaining the content, the more, I always say, the more cheese they find right. as the mouse, you know? So that kid shouldn't be shut off at 18 years old and then just go, okay, this is what you do. You go to guitar school, you know? Right. It makes no sense to us, you know? So we didn't know what we were doing. We came to you. We came to professionals that really understand this stuff. We still have no idea what you do. It's all magic to us.
Oh, by the way, vice versa.
And but we know what the product we want is. We want that kid. I mean, it's no secret that what made Apple great, what still makes Apple great, because Steve Jobs made sure those people that at Apple, he did not suffer fools. I go to Apple now, and I go there twice a week, and these guys all have a feel for what's going on. All are great technologists, but they also understand culture. They all have, because he pounded it into them, or he picked people that had were open to that. And you know, and as far as people copying us, okay, I would love to consider ourselves this little germ of right. Apple of school, of education. And so we know Samsung copied their phone and Google copied Android, copied iOS. So let schools copy us. That's okay.
Oh, absolutely. It's
we'll just move in a different way next year. Confusing.
And that's what we're already doing, actually. The other great thing about the Academy is not just the different mode of training and the mode of education, but as we've seen the profile of the students coming in, they're different. They're different kids. And it's as you say, you know, a single idea or a single path is absolutely an unacceptable compromise to these kids. They want to bring everything they are and everything they do into the Academy.
See, what popular culture is, I spent my whole life, my entire career, 41 years, trying to move the needle of popular culture. I wake up every day trying to do that. Say, okay, what can I do that will also, you know, be big in Malaysia? What do I do? What is it? What is it about Eminem that can push the boundaries everywhere? What is it about, you know, Lady Gaga or U2? What is it about those things that can, and what happens with this school is, of course, we're going to find, but there are millions of these kids. Yeah. What happens when you find something where there is, when you find oil, it's not only there, it's all over. These kids are everywhere. Just no one is telling them what to do or giving them a clue on where to go to school. And I hope to God that this spreads at every school. I don't care. I don't call it copying. I call it like, okay, it's a good idea. Let's go get it, you know? And I hope so. I first of all, I have no idea if we're right or wrong. Again, Dre and I know nothing about higher education. We don't know anything about lower education, you know? but we feel that we do know kids.
Right.
We really understand kids. We spend our lives trying to understand how these guys work, these guys and girls work, and what moves them and what doesn't. And I think what's happening in education, because I have kids, I have four kids that some are going to college and have graduated college, and what they are fundamentally is bored there. Because it's just, you know, you go to the business school or you go to the creative school and you just, man, what happened to my life? This has nothing to do with my life. And that's what I know about higher education. So that looked like the headphone business to me. saying, okay, there's a bunch of people, I guess they're really good schools, but to me, they're missing something, and let's go do something.
Right.
It was that simple. It's going to be up to you guys to take it all the way, but we're going to help.
You are helping. And these kids identify with you a lot, and they are very different thinkers. They multitask at rates that are, kind of staggering to us. They're fearless. They definitely have a different view of the world, and it's kind of a better world that they see, and they have absolutely no problem going, I'm going to get that, and I'm going to change it. Do you see yourself in these Academy kids?
Well, I call it bogey land. It's called getting older, If you're not careful, you could mistake your experience and breathe your own exhaust and not, that's where people just stop growing, I was interested, I was interested in technology when I was a kid because I was a recording engineer and you had to understand something about it in order to do that process, And these kids are fearless, but it's really important that people our age that are either educators or running companies have that enthusiasm and that excitement to say, wow, everything I know right now could possibly be wrong. That's literally, I gotta be honest, I think like that every day. If a kid walks in the kid that brought me M&M could not have been lower on the totem pole. He was 18 years old. He was filling in for my assistant. He was an intern for the summer. He wasn't getting paid. He walked over to me and said, you know what? I saw this white wrapper. And at the time, that was an oxymoron. There was no such thing as a white wrapper. Nobody wanted a white wrapper. No one thought that Vanilla Ice ruined it for everybody for life, right? And I said, you know what? I said to the kid, I'll tell you what, somebody gave me a shot when I was your age. I said, if you get me that CD, I will give it to Dr. Dre. He gave me the CD, and Eminem has earned $1 billion for Universal. And it's because I just assumed, not only did I assume everything that I thought could be wrong, but I assumed every custom, everything in the world could possibly be wrong. I approach every day like that. I really do. It's how I think or don't think.
You said in an Inc. magazine article, quote, you've got to be lucky enough to identify a problem where you think you can help. Did you think you could help in higher education to the extent that you have? Because I have to tell you, the vision that you came to us with has just sparked a fire of change. Not just
that gave me
with
goosebumps.
Us. Well, not just with us at USC, but across the country. I have to tell you, everybody is seeing, wow, we got to look into this. We got to figure out what's going on here.
Well, I got to be honest. All I saw was a problem. I knew my kids. I knew kids that were coming to me for work. If you work in my business, you don't have to do research. I never do research. You don't have to do research with 8 outside firms to find out what's happening right below the surface, So people would come to me and I'm trying to hire a kid and I said, I don't care where he went to school. I said, it doesn't have a feel for what Beats is. Beats is a blending of these two worlds. I said, we need kids like that. And so a friend of mine who went to school said, well, they don't teach like that in school. So I went and talked to my kids and some other kids and I said, oh man, there's a real problem here. This is crazy. So I went to you guys and I said, look, I'm willing to fund this thing if this is a good idea. And you guys took it and ran with it, and it's incredible. But did I know? No, I had, I just saw it very linear, like looking like that,
Yeah. So I want to go back a little bit to a discussion about strategy, because the strategy that we've employed in terms of changing a model for undergraduate education was also in certain respects influenced, by you, and also your influence on higher education
is
growing.
It's called biting.
Yeah.
That's what it's called.
Okay.
In the street. It's called, you bit us.
Okay.
Okay. That means you copied us.
Okay. Okay. Got it. I'll take that.
Okay.
So higher education is continuing to respond both to your ideas and also to what you've started with us. In particular, a lot of people are looking at your marketing approach, which is very, you know, and you keep saying popular culture, it's very oriented to your understanding of popular culture. They're looking at the marketing plan that you used for Beats headphones and that you're now using for Beats Music. And they are both so brilliant, so innovative. Harvard Business School is actually doing a case study on Beats now. And as you put it, they're trying to crack the code of the Beats marketing.
First of all, I'm shocked that they're trying to do a case study on Beats. It's pretty funny to me. But it's fantastic. You know?
It is. It
Somebody
is.
Told me it's fantastic.
It is fantastic, I anyway. Can tell you. Yeah. So tell us a little bit about that, because that also filters down to the way we view the Academy as well. I mean, it was a very different approach.
That's why we have to help these kids have both skills, right? To be fluent in both areas. Because what Beats is, we just said, okay, we have a headphone. This headphone is Guns N' Roses. This headphone is U2. Let's market them like that. Let's market them like they're rock bands or rappers. Or so we go, what penetrates more in the culture than music? Nothing. So let's take this piece of hardware and give it a soul. And that's what we did. We instinctively play it for our friends. We're fortunate to have friends like LeBron James and people like that. But, you know, we did play it. We show them to everybody. But because Dre and I know what music should feel like, and we don't see, there's another story about that's very important in the marketing of Beats. There's headphones. This is a little technical, but headphones are tuned to a standard with an oscilloscope. What they do is they take a sound wave of a record or music, and they look at it and they duplicate that in the headphone. The problem with that is that if you go to a recording studio and you see Bono, Bruce Springsteen, Kanye West, Beyonce, when you go in there, they want to impress you. They don't play it on audiophile speakers. They play a few on the most exciting, emotional speakers that they can find. So what we did is we tuned our headphones like they tuned their studio monitors, because they make headphones and they make speakers for reference. Nobody's referencing if something sounds real. They want excitement. They want entertainment. So when we knew that when we gave these athletes and these musicians our headphones and our speakers, that they were going to be very excited about them, because every other pair of headphones is for reference.
Right. It's neutral.
So that was an enormous thing. To have the, because people tell us we were crazy doing that, which is what, I've heard that story so many times. So, you know, the marketing was about the product has to be aesthetically correct and has to be really good. And then what happens is, if you're fortunate enough to know how to give it to people, you just give it to them and it takes over. Those athletes are not going to wear a headphone because I asked them to wear it. If they're going in to play for the championship of the NBA, they're not going to warm up to my headphones because Dr. Dre or I told them to.
Right.
They're going to warm up because they're exciting and they feel great and they're inspiring. Yeah. So you have to have, marketing starts with the product.
Sean Bryant, in this recent article that I was talking about this morning that came out in Bloomberg, Sean Bryant is a former NBA marketing exec. And he said, quote, when they write the book on seeding products with celebrities and creating a real grassroots movement, the book will certainly include a chapter on Beats.
And well, you know, we also did something else. We took, the record industry has music videos, and Doug Morris was a giant proponent of getting musicians paid for their music videos. They were only promotion at one time. So what we were doing is we say, okay, they go on YouTube. YouTube advertises around the video, and we get this much money. So I said, okay, I could accomplish two things here. How do we get around YouTube? Okay, if they give us the money directly, if Chevrolet gives us the money directly, we put their car in our video, we don't get a percentage, we get the whole thing. So I said, let me prove this. See, part of Beats was proving an experiment on how to make more money out of music. And so I said, okay, all the videos we make, let's put headphones in them to prove to Coke and to Chevy that they can advertise directly with us. The fallout of that was that we sold a lot of headphones, you know,
rather than a lot of advertising.
But believe it or not, companies still don't get it. They don't go directly to the labels and say, okay, how do we market with your artist? Why don't musicians and television studios have them, but why doesn't the music industry have upfronts? They have the most powerful content in the world. Why aren't they meeting with all the advertisers in the world and saying, instead of saying, do you want to put an annoying 15-second commercial in front of a Beyonce video that the kid wants to kill himself for those 15 seconds? Or do you want to advertise inside the content? It's mind-blowing to me. So that's what we did. You know, it's like, but no one does it. Still doesn't happen. So we keep putting our headphones in the videos.
And therefore the case study. because Doug Morris is here. Everybody knows you have a knack for trend spotting. And Doug Morris's quote, which I absolutely love, he said, you can, quote, see around corners. Looking ahead, first of all, what do you see as you know, the future for tech? But also, how do we teach our students to see around corners?
Well, everything in my past, including my walk with my incredible girlfriend this morning, is public. But the future is a private. If I think anything, if I see anything, I keep that to myself. Right? You know what I'm saying?
I remember you and I were talking after we finished recruiting the first class, and I love my phone calls from you, because my phone calls are all just, how are we doing? and I always love reporting to you, because we're doing fantastic. And I said, you know, I don't mind telling you, Jimmy, it's a brand new program. We've recruited an extraordinary class, but, you know, we were in my white knuckle mode for a while. And you said, Erica, every day of my life is figuring out if there's an audience for something.
Yeah, well, you know, I mean, this thing about the future, I was kidding, but no, almost, was that I'm not going to step out of my lane because I have success in one area, think that I'm this educator or going to save the world or anything. I do the best I can to help people that are smarter than me do that. But I just think that education is really ground zero for fixing anything. And right now, there's a lot of kids bored in school, and that's a dangerous thing. You know, there are kids in this school that said to me, you know, I really don't want to go. I don't want to go to college because I feel like I'm losing 4 years. I know a lot of your kids must say that to you, because all four of my kids said it to me. I want to get started. I don't want. Mark Zuckerberg left school. Steve Jobs left school. David Geffen left school. You left school. I said so. You know, it's hard to explain to a kid like, well, that was a lot of luck and a lot of, because they're bored silly in school. And I just thought this was, you know, a way that would be more. And when I go to the school and I see those 30 kids just say, well, we're here 14 hours a day in the garage. Yeah. Like 14 hours a day.
Oh, yeah.
You know, that's amazing. They didn't have class when I went there to see them. They were just there.
They were making stuff.
You know, it was fascinating. So, I don't know. I think there's something here.
Definitely. Our biggest problem is that they want more access to the garage, 24/7, 7 days a week access to the garage. That's our only problem. They want to live there.
We'll build more garages.
Yeah, we're working on that. So just one more question, then I want to get to some audience questions. Springsteen, Lennon, Dr. Dre, Eminem, Lady Gaga, Will.i.am, and dare I say it, USC. You've worked with a very broad spectrum of innovators. What characteristics do you look for in the people that you work with?
Well, I always look for what I think everybody looks for is an enormous curiosity and a hunger, and be willing to put it all on the line for it. You know, saying, okay, this is, I always say that when I was coming up in business, I tell my kids, I said, it's harder for you because when I was coming up, when I used to walk down the street, the sidewalk was collapsing behind me. I said, and it's not collapsing for you, you know? And so you have to find someone that has that energy that's created internally if they don't have the sidewalk collapsing, you know? Right. And I don't care whether it, I want to see just somebody who's enthusiastic and really, really smart. I don't care if they went to school, didn't go to school, or have talent, can play the guitar. I was a terrible guitar player, a terrible musician. But I found my lane in music and producing records where I can contribute to great musicians. So that's what I look for. I look for hunger. I really do. And hunger can come in very wealthy kids or very poor kids. And it doesn't matter. You get somebody who's curious and ambitious. I could teach the rest in my business.
Yeah.
I just need them to be fluent, and I would like for them to be talented in both areas, understand technology and understand the arts or wherever you favor, and then we could take it from there.
Fantastic. So we have a few questions that have come in via, I think, Twitter, and is the technology we're using today. This is what people would like to know. What would you do differently if you were starting out today?
I go to the school that...
There you go.
I'm a marketing guy. Forgive me. I'll tell you what, when I look back, I don't have it. Regrets are crazy, but when I think that it took me till 55 years old to start Beats, I wish that I was just... had more education, more information where I could have seen that earlier. It took me a long time to get, and a lot of struggle to get to that point of being able to understand two businesses. So, you know, I would like to be able to have a bit more information when I was younger. You know, I didn't have it, and I would be more curious right now if I was younger. I just tried more different things, you know?
Right. And what do you see as the most important traits that you need to have as an innovator?
Well, you got to be able to take pain, you know? You got to be able to, whether it's doing a lot of homework or working for somebody you think is a dope or, you know, all that stuff. It's just, it's constant. You got to be able to get up. Because you get knocked down doesn't mean you lost the fight. It just means you didn't get up. That's how you lose, right?
Right.
So you got to be able to just keep going, you know, and you know, I've learned, and I, in fairness to kids, I've learned the balance in my life recently. I have a really fun life right now, and I didn't have a fun life my whole life. I was all about work. I was working 24/7. I don't recommend that to anybody because I think you could be successful and not do that. But you know, I'd have to say that's probably part of the reason I'm here.
I think it might be fun for you to know that we have quite a number of kids who are in the program who could have made a selection from pretty much any college in the country. Their academic stats were that good. And several of them said to us, I wasn't going to college until I found this program. And we thought that was a really telling statement, that it was exactly that type of kid who was thinking differently about the direction of their life. And they saw, like you, in this something that could give them the real preparation for a direction that they didn't think they could go otherwise.
Well, I'm going to turn that back on you and Max, because, and there's a lot of people here that I hear that, you know, support schools and stuff and important people in the community. Max and Erica did exactly what Dre and I did and what Steve Jobs did. I walked into her office with something that was completely outside the box of what was going on in education. And they looked at me and Dre, who have no experience in higher education, you know, and they just said, we're going to do this. It happened. And you could say, well, yeah, you give us $70 million, we'll do anything. But that's not true. They moved quickly. They got it right. They had a feel for every aspect of what we were trying to do. They busted through bureaucracy. They just pushed and pushed until things happened at our speed. And Dre and I move, well, I move fast. Dre's very, very slow. But I made a record for 14 years. Still hasn't come out. But they moved as quick as I move. And that's impossible in a bureaucracy, like especially in a high, in a great school like USC or any of these schools across the country. They moved lightning fast. And there's a real thing to be learned there.
Yeah, there is.
I mean, because there are schools, other schools that I talk to don't move like that.
Yeah. Yeah, well, we had a lot
of support.
You
guys move like Jagger.
We actually called it, program building at the speed of Jimmy. So
it's incredible.
I mean,
but people should know that. I mean, because that's it all in a nutshell. Yeah. To hear something, say, wow, is it possible that a big part of what we're doing is wrong? Mm-hmm. On a train that's moved so far ahead as USC for so many years, and say, well, wait a minute, there's something we can learn here from these guys.
Right, right. Even
that doesn't happen.
I have to say, even the lack of bureaucracy that you find in an institution that is as agile as USC, we even had the small bureaucratic barriers that were there torn down by administration, and they just cleared the path and just allowed us
but
to
that's
go.
That's the people.
So,
and if you or Max leave the school, you'll probably get stuck with two people that can't do this. You know, you have to train people
that
can. I'll show you a lot of companies. Where do you want to start?
Yeah.
You know, take Sony Electronics, yeah. Morita and Ogre. They were incredible visionaries. They were geniuses. They had every piece of real estate that Apple needed to succeed, to become Apple. They bought the first tech company to buy content. They bought Sony Music and Columbia Music and Columbia Movies and Television. They had the licenses. Doug and I gave them the licenses at Universal. They had everything. They had the Walkman. They invented portable music. They had it all. What they didn't have was the management, because those two guys were dead. And Apple's Apple and Sony's Sony because of that. And that's an enormous thing to learn, to train people. If you want your company to go forward, that's what Steve has done so well. Steve Jobs, these guys are incredible that he's left behind. Mm. And it's a responsibility of the CEO to train someone that can replace you. So, you know, that's important for what you guys do.
Yeah. Eddie Q, Johnny Ive.
Yeah, all of them.
Yeah, Tim
Cook. Tim's amazing. Tim bought Beats. Now, I think he's really smart. But we're going to find out. But, you know, he's pushing. He hired Angela from Burberry to run the stores. How clever is that?
Yeah.
Somebody goes, a feel for fashion. What is he selling? Watches, right? Okay, I get that.
Right.
You know? And he's a smart guy.
You've met the academy students a couple of times now.
What's that?
You've met the students in the academy, the first class now. You've had a chance to talk to them. What do you think is maybe one of the most unique features about them?
Well, these kids can get into any school in the world. And they went to a school because they have feel. They said, okay, my instincts tell me, even though this was never a school before, that this is going to be something great. We are going to pioneer this thing. Those are kids I want to hang with. You know,
it's
just that
it's
simple.
True,
Their parents were telling them, are you crazy? This guy's a rapper, a gangster rapper. Let me show you this NWA video. What about Eminem? Like, you going to school? You go, these guys? You know, and these kids said, yeah, we see through all that. We want to go to this school because we believe this is what school is about and is going to be about.
USC has a reputation now for many, many years for breaking ground all over education like this. And I don't think it was lost on these kids that this was something that was gonna go, it was gonna work. I think also the drive and determination of its donors. They look to you as, you know, role models for
this.
Well,
we're in. You know, we wanna be in, we wanna help as much as we can until we get to a point where we're not helping, but we're there and we would love to. We don't like failing at all, you know? So we want this to be really successful.
Yeah, I get that.